You are such a genuine gem. Thank you for clicking on my video. I'm Brooke Makenna, but today's case is about Marjorie West and what really happened to her. This is an unsolved mystery of a little girl who was so completely innocent and had that all shattered within seconds. Now, this went on for years without answers, except for one man thinks that he has found the truth. And the truth was a girl that had been living in secrecy all along. By the way, I post so much content in July for Suspect Summer, so make sure to subscribe down below if that's something you would like to see. Now let's get back to the story. So it was 1938 in Pennsylvania, and Marjorie West was a little four-year-old redhead with blue eyes and freckles. She even spoke in a southern accent. That May 8th, her family of five who lived in Bradford would go to Sunday church, and this consisted of Shirley, who was her father, who was an engineer at a refining company, her mother Cecilia, and her two siblings, 11-year-old Dorothea and 7-year-old Alan. After church, the West parents decided to have kind of a Mother's Day picnic, because this was obviously Mother's Day weekend, and so they went to White Gravel area of McKean County, which was about 40 minutes away from their hometown. Driving along Highway 219, they finally came upon the Allegheny Forest. And this was a place where hunters and fishermen would often go, so it was a very populated area. Now, they had gone there to meet their friends, the Ackerlands, who were another family, to celebrate Mother's Day with them as well, and everything was going smoothly until about 3 p.m. when everyone began to separate. You see, Dorothea and Marjorie, they both wanted to pick wildflowers, and they were just a little while away from where everyone was having this picnic, and the parents told them to be very careful. The father went over and actually checked behind this giant boulder to make sure there was no rattlesnakes. Now, the father didn't see anything, but of course told the girls to be very careful and to stay, you know, away from the boulder so that they could still see them. But at this point, while they were picking the wildflowers, their mother Cecilia went to the car that was on the road to just kind of rest and I'm sure get away from the chaos. And their father was actually preparing to go trout fishing with Mr. Ackerland. And so everyone was kind of distracted at this time. But that was when Dorothea, Marjorie's older sister, would take the bouquet that she had picked to her mother who was in the car. At this point, she didn't realize that her little sister Marjorie was not following behind, and when she went back to get her, she had disappeared. Now, immediately this family got in their car. Some of them were searching at the area, some of them got in the car and had to drive 7 miles just to get to a phone to call the police. Once they did, of course, they immediately came out, and over 200 men would be involved in searching this area at first, and all of the flashlights in the area were completely used to the point where oilmen were coming in with their headlamps just to get that extra light as it turned dark out. And in the early morning hours, a cold rain would fall and make this search even harder, because not only were they now searching in the cold rain, but evidence was being washed away. Now, the next day, newspaper coverage came out, and so the search party grew to a party of 500 men, and they searched a 4-square-mile area. Now, the next day, Marjorie was still missing, making it a full 48 hours since she had disappeared. And of course, this, in a missing persons case, is a very long amount of time, and every hour just makes it less likely that they're going to find them. And so they decided to bring down bloodhounds from New York to search the area. And there are different sources saying different things about what these bloodhounds actually found, because some say these dogs actually followed a trail up a mountain to a cabin that had the door nailed shut. And when they went inside this cabin, they didn't find anything or any sign of Marjorie, but other sources say that this didn't lead up a mountain into a cabin. It actually led to the road alongside the clearing. With these searches, one of the only clues found was actually a bouquet of violets right next to that boulder that they had been plucking the flowers from that evening. and it was a bouquet of violets smashed into the ground. Now, police began interviewing motorists from a 300 square mile area to see if they had seen anything or to basically just search their cars for Marjorie as well. And witnesses came forward saying that around the time of the disappearance, where the West family was having their picnic, there was about 2 to 3 cars that had driven by. Now, they could obviously identify these cars, and police found 2 of the 3 and interviewed these people, searched them, and didn't find anything to do with Marjorie, and so they were pretty much cleared. However, the third one was said to be a Plymouth sedan that was never found, that was seen speeding out of this area so quickly that there was a car on oncoming traffic that had to pull into a ditch to be safe from this car. 3 days into this search and into her disappearance, the mayor actually pleaded with the public to get people to come out and search, and actually invited 1,000 people. But the next day, he would actually get 2,500 volunteers. And this lasted for about a week, searching 35 square miles. And it started out at 8 a.m. with men standing shoulder to shoulder, just awaiting the signal to go and search into the forest. Marjorie was still nowhere to be seen, but they were finding more clues, including a scrap of lace, which originally they thought could possibly be part of the outfit she was wearing. However, her mother said there was no lace on her clothing that day, and they also did find a freshly dug grave. However, when they dug this up, it was found that it was just a cask of cherry wine. Now, there were engineers pumping out muddy wells. There were Native Americans tracking mother bears who were known to carry off young children, but still Marjorie was missing. Now, believing that Marjorie had wandered off into the forest and was in need of help, her father actually didn't leave the forest for a week, and after that week of searching, he was forced to go home, where he had a meal and basically went right back as soon as he had finished his meal to continue searching. Her mother, however, stayed home the entire time in case somebody called, in case she came home. So they were both at the perfect places in case she was found and needed them. Now, missing persons posters, of course, went up, and they were describing exactly what Marjorie was wearing at the time. It was a blue dress, a navy blue mid-length coat with a collar edged in pink, a red Shirley Temple-style hat, and patent leather shoes. And once this description of what Marjorie was wearing went out, a taxi driver from Thomas, West Virginia, called in, and he said that the night of her disappearance, he had seen a girl that looked like Marjorie wearing what appeared to be that same outfit, was with an unidentified male in his 30s in a dark green sedan. Now, this was about 11:38 p.m., and the taxi driver actually talked to this man, and the man had told him that he was with his daughter and asked him if there was any motels in the area. The taxi driver pointed him across the street to a motel, where he went inside, left the girl in the sedan, and then quickly came back out saying that there was no vacancy, and asked the taxi driver where the nearest liquor store was. The taxi driver told him about the bar down the road, and that was really the last time he ever saw him. Now, I could not find a description of this man, and I'm not sure if it was ever released to the public, but allegedly another sighting in Thomas, West Virginia, was from a gas station attendant who said that the man that kind of appeared to be the same man that the taxi driver had spoken to was at the gas station and had a bundle in the back seat of his car. It was like something wrapped in a gray blanket. However, police say they had tracked down this exact man, and he was Conrad Fridley, and he said he was with his 5-year-old daughter, Lois, and they were coming from Parsons, and they had to stop because of the fog, and she was frustrated, she was crying, and so that's why she was so upset. But they got the hotel and they left early that morning so he could head back to his shop. Now, many theories came out about what actually happened to her. Some said that she was taken by other family members. Some said she was abducted and taken to Canada. Some people said to the southern United States, or that she was possibly on her own in the forest and fell down an abandoned oil well. But the most likely theory in most people's eyes was that she was abducted and sold, because this was the time of the Great Depression and many people were struggling to make money. However, some had gotten by selling children, kidnapping them and selling them for profit. Now, whether making the money off these children was to other people who wanted to buy these children or to give ransom to the parents, they were making this money. And especially with cars being so new, it was making it much easier to abduct them. And however, there was a $2,000 reward for Marjorie's disappearance and information, and it was never collected and no ransom note was ever given to her family. But you see, fast forward 12 years to 1950, and many believed that Marjorie was a victim of this case that had just been flung wide open. However, this wasn't a serial killer or murder case at all. You see, on September 12th, 1950, Georgia Tan was being investigated. She was the executive director of the Memphis branch of the Tennessee Children's Home Society. Now, the allegations stated that he had been selling babies, and this was because he'd been abducting them or taking them from poor parents who didn't know any better and had sold them to wealthy parents who had no idea where these children were coming from, kind of like an illegal adoption agency, and had done this with as many as 1,200 babies from the 1930s until the 1950s. And throughout the years, Georgia had placed many different babies with people in New York and Los Angeles, and no one has ever come forward to say that Marjorie was one of them, that they had adopted Marjorie from this agency. And there was also another case that was possibly thought to be connected in a very far-fetched way, and that was that two boys had been abducted around the same area, like 11 miles and then 19 miles away from where Marjorie was last seen in 1910. You see, it was April 16th, 1910, and 9-year-old Edward Adams was out fishing with his friends when they heard a wild man out in the woods just kind of cursing, and so they all started to run. However, when they looked back, Edward was not with them and was not seen after that. A few miles away, Michael Stephan, who was a 7-year-old, was also fishing with a friend when they were walking home, and he vanished as well. In the town that Edward lived in, a few weeks later, there was actually a ransom note saying, "We'll return boy for $10,000. However, it was just left on railroad tracks and not given to his family. Those boys were never seen again, and of course, Marjorie wasn't being found either. And a few weeks after Marjorie had disappeared, a few months actually, in September, there was a man in the woods who was arrested for assaulting another man after an argument with an axe. Allegedly, he was questioned about Marjorie's disappearance, but was cleared. Now, most of Marjorie's family do still have that hope that she's alive, and in 2012 actually put their DNA in the National Database for Missing Persons and didn't get any matches, unfortunately, but there of course is still hope. But there is a man who believes he knows exactly what happened to her because he talked to her. His name is Harold Thomas Bud Beck, and he has a PhD in linguistics. Now, he was a college professor who heard about this case because he also owned a bar, and of course the guests there were talking about it, and he decided to start researching it. And then in 1998, when the internet was really coming around, he posted a $10,000 reward as well as pictures of Marjorie's older sister Dorothea, because they resembled each other like crazy, in hopes that somebody would recognize her sister. And that is when a woman who worked at a company in Florida contacted Harold and said she worked with a nurse who really resembled these pictures. And so Harold went down to Florida to talk to her, and she was obliging to talk to him, except for she denied that she was Marjorie, but she did look a lot like her. In 2005, however, this nurse went back to her childhood farm in North Carolina and contacted Harold because she was ready to talk. And that's when she allegedly began to tell Harold about a story her mother had told her on her deathbed. It began in back in 1938 when this nurse's father was leaving to go to work at Bradford's refinery that winter. That spring, he was driving home past the Allegheny Forest when he hit a little girl. He put her in the car and thought she was dead and was going to actually go take her to the hospital when she awoke and seemed fine. And that is when he decided to take her back to their farm. They were going to raise her as their own because they had just lost their little girl that winter, and the childbirth had been so horrible for his wife that they feared they couldn't have any more children. This nurse said that she had often told her parents about this other family that she remembered, but they always just dismissed it. Now, her father, or this man who had taken her, had allegedly lost his arm in the Second World War and said that it was God's way of punishing him for what he had done. And this couple later had 4 more children. But Harold was only told this story because he promised not to tell anyone except for Dorothea, whom this nurse wanted to meet, until after she died. Now, unfortunately, Dorothea was too ill by this point to actually go and meet this nurse, so they never actually met. And in 2010, this nurse, who is thought to be Marjorie, passed away. And it's not believed that Harold ever told authorities about his findings, saying, "What is it going to accomplish?" However, I'm not sure that that was the best decision on his part. However, this case is still unsolved today, so if you know anything, please contact the Pennsylvania State Police at 814-938-0510. But do you think this story that this nurse told could be true? I mean, I see that if it was Mother's Day weekend, that would be a very horrible time for parents who had lost a child, and so that could have possibly been, you know, he could have been in a bad spot grieving wise. He had been talking to his wife and maybe she was in a bad spot, and so that's what he thought he should do. Possibly he didn't even hit her at all. Maybe he really just abducted her and that's the story he told to make himself feel a little better. I would have loved to know if he was the one driving that Plymouth that was seen speeding out of the area, because that would really tell whether or not it was a hit or an abduction. Although, I mean, I guess he could have been speeding to get her to a hospital as well. Or could this have just been that Marjorie got lost in the rough terrain and unfortunately got hurt somewhere and was never found? Although I can't really see her getting so far that the search teams that searched for miles would not have found her. I think that it was an unfortunate abduction, and for me, I think that the story the nurse told, I almost hope for it because she was abducted and I would have rather her lived a good life with parents who wanted a child than with some creep who wanted to take advantage of her. However, I know that, you know, those parents still should have been in trouble for what they did. I do hope that if it was abduction, she got the best life possible out of it, even if she had to leave her birth family. Now, this case is similar to my life, but extremely creepy when researching it. Not only does this girl have red hair, blue eyes, and freckles like I do, but she was also missing on May 8th, which is my birthday. And I've always had this gut feeling in me that when my past life, if you believe in those, that I was chased and beaten. And I actually have birthmarks that kind of, if you believe in that birthmarks come from how you died in your past life, it makes sense. And so when I read this case, I don't know, I just felt like a soul connection to it, and it creeped me out entirely. But yeah, there's also the fact that her case was connected to possibly an illegal adoption scheme, and then my parents in this life have adopted kids. I don't know, it's crazy, but I'd love to hear your theories on this one. Don't ever forget to speak up. Your voice is powerful enough, and I love you to absolute pieces. Okay, bye.